Yeah, feel this from the bottom of my heart, y'all. Truly inspired. Here we go. Come on.
What's up, everyone? Welcome back to We Rise Fighting. This is our second edition. In today's edition, we're going to talk about some labor theory. We're going to talk about business unionism and social justice unionism, the different versions of social justice unionism, what that is, what that looks like, how that affects what happens in our unions, stuff like that. We're going to get into it, folks. Right after this, we're going to hear a little bit of Rebel Diaz. Song called Chicago Teacher. Shout out to Chicago Teacher and the teacher struggle. Full of violence, the blue coat is silence. So I'ma keep rhyming till salaries start rising. The unions are rising, taking to the streets. The workers are united, so the mayor's got beef. Rhymes a fake pretender with a corporate agenda. Neoliberal offender, of course you offend us. All right, welcome back. My name is Rick Urrutia. I am here with my friends and comrade Jerry Scapatullo and Brian Pfeiffer. We are here putting together We Rise Fighting. And first, we're going to kick things off with the news. Brian?
All right. We have Hershey workers that work at a plant in Stewartstrap, Virginia. About 1,000 of them are in the process of organizing their union. So please keep an eye out on that. We're going to need some support. Very important struggle. It's in the South, in Virginia. The other big happenings last week and this week, St. Paul, Minneapolis Federation of Teachers, the unions there, are on the verge of a potential strike. They're actually at the table now, and they could potentially go out on March 8th. So keep a lookout on that. That could be a very important strike for education workers and all workers generally across the country. So those are two major actions happening. Right now, of just a few that are going on across the country, including the Starbucks workers. And Jerry will tell us about that.
Okay, Starbucks workers are organizing at a furious pace across the country. Every week, two or three new stores petition for union elections. Here in Boston, two stores got election dates on April 6th for Starbucks. That's about 50 or 60 workers. But the important thing to remember is the national picture of which you can look on the National Labor Relations Board website and see which states have active union organizing drives and petitions and elections going on. So here in Boston, it's a combination of Workers United, affiliated with SEIU, and Unite Here General Board. Those two unions are the unions that are wrapping it all up. And finally, to say that here in Boston, there was a meeting this week of 40 or so Starbucks workers from five or six different stores. And what they've done is they've scaled it up to now there's a barista coalition in Boston that's going after all cafes with any unions that want to organize them. So this thing is growing, and it's just growing on its own.
All right, thank you. And you know what? On my end, I have one more bit to throw into our labor news. I just wanted to give a shout out to Eden Cobham workers in Davenport, Iowa, for holding it down. They were on strike. Their strike began on Friday, February 18th. And you know, this little bit of news made the Baltimore Sun caught my attention, specifically because this factory makes airplane parts for defense contractors, specifically parts that allow the planes that can be refueled in midair, parts for planes that can be refueled in midair. It's 365 union members represented by the International Association of Machinists. And this one just kind of caught my attention and caught my imagination, because this is part of what we're going to be talking about, right? Like, you hear about this news here in this one small shop, but why can't this happen all across the board? Why can't this happen all across the military industrial complex? And why can't workers stop production for the military industrial complex and stop wars? You know, that's the kind of thing that we're getting into today. Some theory, some business unionism and social justice theory. So let me go ahead and kick this off. So, you know, let me start by kicking it off and asking, what is theory? You know, theory is nothing more than ideas. And in the case of labor theory, there are ideas that guide the strategies and actions of unions, workers, and the labor movements. Okay, and for the sake of this podcast, we've made the distinction between business unionism and social justice unionism. Now, let's go ahead and start with business unionism. Okay, this is a theory that speaks to the vast, vast majority of unions in the United States at the moment. The basic understanding of it is that unions are only there to concern themselves with bread and butter issues or economic issues and nothing else. So in other words, focusing on wages, healthcare, schedules, workplace conditions, breaks, paid time off, stuff like that. And there's nothing wrong with that, but that's where the vision ends. There's no grander vision of a better world for the international working class. The union leadership is mostly just there to negotiate the terms of the members' exploitation, if you will. The union leadership also donates money to political candidates and representatives, candidates and representatives who they think will be most sympathetic towards the union's cause. Also, another characteristic of business unionism is that for whatever reason, the elected leadership often makes a lot more money than the rank and file. In the job site, you have business representatives who will process your grievances if you feel the contract has been violated. And also, for all these reasons just mentioned, the union is kind of thought of as a third party agency, kind of like an insurance agency or a law firm. You know, it's kind of members become a little disattached from their own union. If you want to read more about the origins and theories of business unionism, you can read the theories and the writings of people like Selig Perlman, Frederick Taylor, John R. Commons, Sam Gompers, Stephen Lerner of SEIU more recently. And you can also read about things labor management partnerships. Now, by contrast, social justice unionism, as the name suggests, has a vision that goes way beyond simply negotiating economic issues for the membership. Okay, social justice unionism attaches itself to civil rights causes, climate justice and international worker struggles, anti-war activities, anti-fascist activities, revolutionary struggles. Social justice unionism also has its theories and theorists, of course. So for instance, a few of my favorites, I should say, are Karl Marx, Rosa Luxemburg, Eugene Debs. Also within the spectrum of the U.S. labor movement and U.S. labor history, there's the Knights of Labor. You know, they were amongst the first unions to welcome all workers, regardless of gender, age, race. The only people that the Knights of Labor excluded against, unfortunately, were Chinese workers. You know, but nevertheless, their level of inclusion was something revolutionary at the time. You know, picking up where the Knights of Labor left off, came the industrial workers of the world. You know, they're known as anarcho-syndicalists, and their vision was even broader. You know, they included all workers, regardless of race, all workers, regardless of gender and immigration status, all of that. You know, they didn't concern themselves with that. They wanted to create one big union so that workers could take over and seize the means of production. And they wanted to combat capitalism by declaring general strikes in key industries. And then again, taking over, seizing the means of production. So their vision was a lot grander. Moving along through labor history, you know, eventually comes the Congress of Industrial Organizations, or the CIO. The CIO was born in the 1930s to contest the labor organizing of the already existing American Federation of Labor. The American Federation of Labor was almost exclusively focused on organizing skilled white men and weren't as involved in organizing workers of color and industry. And so this is something that the CIO took upon itself. Now, another little quote-unquote blip or moment that happened in U.S. labor history that I like to mention because it's one that really inspired me and captured my imagination was the Dodge Revolutionary Union movement that took place in Michigan, in Flint, Michigan, and in Detroit. You know, I like to toss this one out because it brings together a few theoretical understandings. For me, this particular struggle was important because it was led by Black workers. And part of why it captures my imagination is because it happened right there in Detroit, man, in Flint, you know, right in the belly of the beast, right in the belly of the industrial beast in the United States. And I can't help but let that capture my imagination, because it's like you have these black workers just really, you know, kind of contesting that and going on wildcat, going on wildcat strikes, and, you know, just making the union leadership of the UAW nervous, making Chrysler nervous, making Ford nervous, because the Dodge Revolutionary Union movement spread, and it adopted, you know, some of the black power consciousness and rhetoric of the time, and also anti-war rhetoric at the time. So it was a very, very exciting thing. And I think it just deserves its own mention because of that. Also coming out of Detroit and speaking to social justice union movement, social justice unionism, is Labor Notes magazine. I like to throw that in there because, you know, this has been a tool for, good Lord, I know since the 70s, you know, for workers looking to reform their unions, make them more democratic, you know, finding new and creative ways to take on the boss, or maybe just redusting the old ways, dusting off the old ways of taking on the boss. So those are all examples of social justice unionism that has taken place. There's also examples of hybrids between social justice unionism and business unionism. And amongst those hybrids, I would include the UPS strike of 1997. I would include that because, yes, the Teamsters, which represented the UPS workers, the Teamsters were very much concerned with economic issues for their membership, but they turned it into a grander struggle for workers in the United States. You know, one of their battle cries was part-time America won't work. And this is something that a lot of workers in the United States at the time and still could latch on and relate to and get behind and extend their solidarity to UPS strikers. You know, already mentioned also our movements for union democracy and union reform. Another hybrid I would think of is SEIU and Justice for Janitors, you know, very much concerned with economic issues, but has also embraced the cause and the struggle of immigrant workers in the US, as well as John Sweeney during his administration with the AFL. As far as another hybrid, I would actually include Change to Win Coalition in there. And I would say it's a hybrid because it dusted off some of the theoretical understandings of John R. Commons, one of business unionism's theorists, and it sprinkles a little social justice on top, you know, because SEIU Unite Here, just by virtue of the types of workers that they're organizing, immigrant workers, black workers, Latino workers, you know, just by virtue of the types of workers that they're organizing, they have to adopt some social justice leanings, you know, in order to make that happen. And, you know, last but not least, there's also teacher strikes, you know, and the last 5 or 6 years, we have seen a lot of strikes and activities in the world of teachers. And oftentimes, these striking teachers make demands that go outside of just bread and butter issues and just go outside of demands just made in the classroom. You know, Brian's going to speak on that a little bit. And I encourage you, if you want to read more on different labor theories, their origins, where they came from, there's a book called Theories of the Labor Movement. It's edited by Simeon Larson and Bruce Nissen. I hope I'm saying their names correctly. But, you know, a lot of the authors that I've mentioned in my segment come from this book. And, you know, from there, you can take it on to other authors. It's a good way to introduce yourself to the theories of the labor movement. So without further ado, Brian, can you please fill us in what's going on and what's happened with the world of teachers as far as social justice unionism, you know, their place in the U.S. labor struggle in recent years? Karen Lewis, Brian, please speak.
All right. Thanks, Brother Rick. Really appreciate that presentation. Very valuable, important labor history for today's struggles. As we move forward, there's a lot of movement happening across the country, and these labor battles of the past and theory is absolutely essential to moving forward and to making our unions effective. So what we what I'd like to raise today is we're talking about I'm specifically going to raise some education struggles, and some of you might remember in Wisconsin in 2011 in February, the governor at the time, Scott Walker, had a press conference and said that he was going to push through the right wing legislature something called Act 10. At the time, they called it the quote unquote budget repair bill, and essentially it was an austerity bill to wipe out public sector collective bargaining in the state of Wisconsin. And there was a mass upsurge to this in February of 2011, 3 weeks. There was occupations at a state capitol of all ages, nationalities, genders, orientations from all over the state of Wisconsin and beyond. And the question that arose out of that, we lost that battle, and that act was actually implemented and signed into law. And since then, there has been a conservative estimate of $30 billion wealth transfer in the last 10 years. Many rights have been taken away, and that really set the stage for right to work being passed in Wisconsin in 15 and that whole variety of other austerity. So what Rick was saying is we're not just talking about these labor theories as esoteric activities. These are literally life and death. What kind of theory is going to undergird our orientation into our organization? Because if we have the incorrect theory, we can't apply organization correctly, and we will end up getting a lot of losses and ending up in situations that might take forever or never to recover from. So what happened in 11, it sparked in 2010, actually before Wisconsin, but there was a caucus formed in Chicago, and by Sister Karen Lewis, who was a chemistry teacher, and she was one of eight teachers who formed the Caucus of Rank and File Educators. And one of the things that I found interesting is there's a rethinking, this is from an interview in Rethinking Schools in 2012, that's the publication, that I found interesting was that they actually formed that caucus to fight school closings. And back to what Rick said about social justice unionism, Sister Lewis understood that, like a lot of education unions across the country, like Milwaukee, Chicago, the ones that have transformed themselves into social justice unions over the past like 10 years, they understood that there was no advance and they could not be viable in today's world with the students in motion, with Black Lives Matter, with the school closings, all the attacks on historical truth, et cetera, if they weren't united with the community and with the students. So this caucus formed to stop school closings because the school closings were happening mostly in Black and Brown communities. And what that did is that solidified themselves with those communities, that they cared about them, that they were going to fight for their issues as well as fighting for the bread and butter issues of the union. So they came out with slogans such as fighting for the schools our students deserve, right? That our conditions as educators in the classroom is directly related to the conditions of our students. So if we have 40 or more students in a classroom, that affects everybody in a negative way, right? It stresses out teachers. The teachers can't teach well. The students aren't getting the services that they need. And the fault of all of that is the capitalists, right? The austerity, the people like that. So the caucus came out in 08 and they ran for president, Sister Lewis, and she won. And then in 2012, the Chicago teachers went out on strike over the issues of stopping school closings, to stop the austerity, and all the other issues that educators should have, right? Decent livable wages and benefits and having a say in collective bargaining over classroom sizes and a whole variety of other issues. So that strike happened, and the CTU is about a 27,000 member union. It's an American Federation of Teachers affiliate. And at the time they went on a strike, Rahm Emanuel was the mayor. And Rahm Emanuel was in the Barack Obama administration. And Rahm Emanuel came to Chicago with the intent of doing a Wisconsin in Chicago. And he quickly learned that the Chicago Teachers Union was not going to let that happen, and they didn't. So they went out on strike, and they won the strike successfully. And that strike, I would argue, really launched a whole new shift in education unionism and struggles across the entire country. So since 2012, we've seen a whole variety of this type of activity. And one of the other items that I want to point to in Lewis is that, Sister Lewis, is that she, of course,
she was a president of a union, so has to fight for her members, bread and butter issues. But also that legislative activities are important because we do need folks that understand public education, but that's not going to win what we need with our community. One of the quotes I appreciated in her article or the interview was that she, quote, "Our best tool is our ability to put 20,000 people in the street. I don't care if one rich guy buys up all the ad space. The tool that we have is a mass movement. We have the pressure of mass mobilization and organizing, and we have the first line of defense, which is the parents." And that really, in my view, really articulates where we're heading here in 2022. Since the 2012 strike, the CTU also went on strike again in this last time period. And then in 2018, West Virginia educators shut down the entire state of West Virginia. And that sparked a movement across the country. So since 2018, in Oklahoma, Arizona, the United Teachers of Los Angeles went on strike, Oakland went on strike. And now the educators in St. Paul and Minneapolis are going to potentially be going out on strike on March 8th. But what is the commonality between all of this? It's similar to what Rick raised in Drum, right? In the CIO struggles of the 1930s, that these education locals that are moving in this direction, the Milwaukee Teachers Education Association, the only reason they're alive, I would argue, is because of this type of an approach, especially in the anti-union climate now in Wisconsin, is that the commonality is that all of them have taken the approach of uniting the students and the parents with the community and fighting for public education in concert with their union. And that's where we're going to go from here. You know, these are not necessarily new concepts in this country. In the United States, as Rick and Jerry will be explaining later, there's a mighty, mighty history of workers. And all, us three have been involved in a lot of this activity in the past quarter century or longer. Of this type of activity. In the 1930s, we saw massive upsurges. We saw, you know, wildcat strikes in the 60s and 70s with educators in the public sector taking the lead, the 1970 postal workers strike. So this is one of the reasons why we're having the podcast, is to raise this for discussion on where we're going to be going in the future. Because the way that we are living in this country today, that we are not going to make advances, in our view, without social justice unionism and taking on these issues that we're facing. So I'll leave it there for Jerry. Jerry is a great scholar, labor historian, and union activist. And he has some great contributions to make in terms of some history of labor and some other items. So thanks again, Rick. And Jerry, take it from here. Thanks.
Thank you, Brian. I'm just going to mention a couple of examples. Brian said just now that social justice unionism is not a new concept, and that is very true. Word is finally beginning to get out about the record of the Marine Cooks and Stewards Union in the 1930s and what they did to advance social justice unionism and to smash down racist barriers to union membership. In the 1930s, on the West Coast, in the famous 34 General Strike, led by ILWU, the Teamsters, and about 22 other unions, the issue was, one of the big issues was racism and the fact that on the docks, black stevedores and dock workers could not get jobs either as stewards on big ocean liners for the rich, or just by unloading transit ships off the docks. So the Marine Cooks and Stewards Union fought to desegregate the hiring process by forcing the shipping industry to use hiring halls that were non-racist, where the union had a voice in hiring, to replace the old system by which favoritism and white racism kept black workers out of jobs in the daily shape up, which is where you would report to work and see if you could get a job by either bribing somebody or by being white. So they led the fight on that along with the ILWU. So that by 1936, hiring halls were desegregated on the West Coast. And another thing the National Union of Marine Cooks and Stewards did was to unite black workers, Chinese workers, and gay workers together their slogan was no race baiting, no queen baiting, and no red baiting. What happened in that union was that a 24-year-old Revels Caton, a communist, a young communist, joined the union to become a stevedore and literally desegregated it by gaining the support of the gay white communists who worked on the ships, so that when the union went on strike during the 1934 and 1936 big West Coast strikes, they promised that if black workers did not cross the picket lines, they would be taken into the union as full partners. And Revels Caton led that struggle as a black man, also with the help of white communists, the leading members of which were white communists, gay communists. And together they desegregated so that when they won the strike, the black workers all came into the union, which previously had been an all-white union by decree of the ship owners. But the union forced them to desegregate. Okay, so that's one example. Word is getting out about that. Word has also gotten out about Local 22, the food and tobacco workers in the South in the 1940s, and the fact that that union, 100,000 strong, was a union that the food and tobacco workers union, its previous identity was that of Yukapawa, United Cannery Workers, consciously elevated into leadership women, women of color, and black workers as a duty of the union. And that led to some strong unions of pecan shellers and agricultural workers in California, led by women. And in Tennessee, the food and tobacco workers desegregated by virtue of organizing the R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company R.J. Reynolds in North Carolina. 10,000 workers, they organized all those workers in the biggest union strike of 1943 and elevated into leadership a black woman, Miranda Smith, who by the end of the decade was the highest elected black woman in organized labor, and she was in the Jim Crow South. She was also a same gender loving woman. And this was probably not known except to a few of her communist intimate friends whom I knew. Another example of social justice unionism, moving on to the next couple of decades, was the Vietnam War. Now, the media and mainstream historians like to point to the hard hat strike on the hard hat riot on Wall Street. I think it was in 1970, where hard hat union members beat up a few hippies who were protesting the war. Well, yes, that may have been an example that actually did happen, but in truth, organized labor, many unions, many international unions opposed the Vietnam War, going against what George Meany, the president of the AFL-CIO, wanted. District 1199, United Auto Workers, the food and tobacco workers were gone by then, having been red baited out of history. But many unions actually opposed the Vietnam War. The full story of that is to be found in Phil Foner's book, Labor in the Vietnam War. Also, during the Vietnam War, the National Peace Action Coalition, which was probably the biggest mass organization of the Socialist Party, Socialist Workers Party, organized dozens and dozens of central labor councils, local unions, union presidents to oppose the Vietnam War during the several mass mobilizations during Vietnam, especially April 1971. On the West Coast and on the East Coast. A leader of that organizing of labor unions against the Vietnam was Howard Wallace, who later became the founder of Pride at Work, the official LGBT constituency group of organized labor. Another example going back to the 30s was in the CIO, basically the CIO and the its major industrial unions. I wouldn't go so far as to say that they were the civil rights movement, but they were the biggest section of the civil rights movement during the late 1930s up until the end of the 1940s. Their Committee Against Racial Discrimination was an effort by the Executive Board of the CIO to fight discrimination in all of its locals. The United Packing House Workers were especially notably successful in this. They had their own Fair Employment Practice Committee, which policed racism within their own unions. And they, you know, of course, that struggle was really terribly hurt by the red purge of the CIO unions in 1949-50. But nevertheless, there was a big, strong attempt before then with the formation of the CIO in 1936. And finally, getting back to Vietnam again, sorry for jumping around, I forgot to mention that for 2 years, there was an alliance between the Teamsters under Freddie Fitzsimmons and UAW under Walter Reuther that had a union coalition of their own against the Vietnam War. It didn't accomplish a hell of a lot, but it was an example of the other side of the story about unions in the Vietnam War. You know, I think today, in today's world, for me, a leading example is Joint Council 10 of the Teamsters in New York, or I think in New York or New Jersey, where they've just declared themselves a sanctuary union, where they're going to fight for the rights and the continued ability to stay within the United States of so-called non-documented workers who are union members in their union. And as Rick suggested earlier, the unions are representing more and more a different workforce, a different demographic of people of color. And so unions, the smart ones, are responding to that by taking up the issues that their workers need help on and need solidarity on. So that's just a couple of examples of civil rights unionism, and hopefully there'll be more in the future. So I'm going to hand it back over to Rick.
Thank you, Jerry. I just love listening to my comrades on this show, man. That's part of the enjoyment in doing this podcast. You know, y'all get me thinking through all parts of U.S. labor history, you know, from the stuff we've discussed on this episode. It just reminds me, you know, the UAW wouldn't exist if it wasn't for the intervention of the Communist Party. You know, at the very beginning of the organizing towards the United Auto Workers, you had white workers going on strike because they had to work next to black workers. You know, they would just go on wildcat strikes to protest having to work next to black workers. It wasn't until the Communist Party rolled in and said, yeah, no, this isn't going to happen unless we include all workers. You know, and that's where this theoretical stuff comes in, man. That's, Brian, you are absolutely right. This stuff is life or death. This stuff is very material. You know, this stuff, you know, either employs you, puts food in your gut, doesn't put food in your gut, brings social justice to the community or doesn't bring it, you know, brings about, you know, a struggle for climate justice or doesn't. You know, these are important questions that these theoretical questions bring about. So, yeah, thank you. Thank you, Comrade Brian. Thank you, Comrade Jerry. This has been a fascinating episode of We Rise Fighting. We will be back with you shortly as soon as we get our next episode recorded. Looks like our next episode is either going to be about different combat methods for labor or an anti-war labor podcast. We are still in the process of sorting that out, but we look very much forward to sharing it with you, our listeners, and thank you for listening. Big hugs to everyone. Thank you, comrades, for being on board, and we will speak to all of you soon. Have a good day, everyone.
Thank you. I'll let you continue.
Out ready forever, baby.
We've been shot and we've been jailed, Lord. It's a sin. Women and little children stood right by the men. But we got that union contract that keeps the workers free.